Every town has its ups and downs. Some towns' ups outnumber the downs, but not in Nottingham. I'm inclined to believe if we weren't so down, we'd up and leave. We'd up and fly if we had wings for flying. Can't you see the tears we're crying? Can't there be some happiness for me? Not in Nottingham.
I am the man who has seen affliction by the rod of the Lord's wrath. He has driven me away and made me walk in darkness rather than light. Indeed, he has turned his hand against me again and again all day long. He has made my skin and my flesh grow old and has broken my bones. He has besieged me and surrounded me with bitterness and hardship. He has made me dwell in darkness like those long dead. He has walled me in so I cannot escape. He has weighed me down with chains. Even when I cry out for help, he shuts out my prayer. He has barred my way with blocks of stone. He has made my path crooked like a bear lying in wait, like a lion in hiding. He dragged me from the path and mangled me and left me without help. He withdrew his bow and made me the target for his arrows. He pierced my heart with arrows from his quiver. I became the laughingstock of all my people. They mock me in song all day long. He has filled me with bitter herbs and given me gall to drink. He has broken my teeth with gravel. He has trampled me in the dust. I have been deprived of peace. I have forgotten what prosperity is. And so I say, my splendor is gone and all that I have hoped for from the Lord. I remember my affliction and my wandering, the bitterness and the gall. I remember them, and my soul is downcast within me. Yet I call this to mind, and therefore I have hope. Because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed, for his compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. I say to myself, the Lord is my portion. Therefore, I will wait for him. The Lord is good to those whose hope is in him, to the one who seeks him. It is good to wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord. It is good for a man to bear the yoke while he is young. Let him sit alone in silence, for the Lord has laid it on him. Let him bury his face in the dust. There may yet be hope. Let him offer his cheek to one who would strike him, and let him be filled with disgrace. For no one is cast off by the Lord forever. Though he brings grief, he will show compassion. So great is his unfailing love, for he does not willingly bring affliction or grief to anyone. Can we pray? Heavenly Father, I thank you that you see us and you know us. I thank you, Lord, you know what each of us have gone through and are going through and have experienced and will experience. And Lord God, I thank you that we can decide to say, great is your faithfulness. I thank you that we can decide to look at what you are doing and not at what left's undone. I thank you, Lord God, that you can teach us how to hope like all those who for centuries who that have gone before us have had to learn. Help us to learn it so we can pass it on to the next. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, that's a different way to introduce the sermon, right? It's a different way to think about everything we're going through. It's a legitimate way. I mean, two-thirds of the Psalms are Psalms of Lament. What I just read was Lamentations 3. It's Jeremiah pouring out his heart after Jerusalem was sacked, after all the hopes and dreams, after every prophecy that said Jerusalem would never be taken, fell down. It rings true today, doesn't it? It rings true in our situation. It rings true for what we have to go through. I want to talk today about what to do when you want to give up. And we need to start by talking about discouragement. All of us are going to have times when we feel weary. All of us are especially true during this time of self-imposed exile for the good of the realm. We're going to have seasons. We're going to have times where, you know, we're doing the best we can with what we can do. And it gets long. It feels like it's not going to end. It feels, what are we going to do in this? I need you to know, though, that we're talking about discouragement today. And there's a difference between discouragement and depression. Depression is not just simply a temporary change in mood or a sign of weakness. It's a real medical condition with many emotional, physical, behavioral, and cognitive symptoms. You can find out more at depressionhurts.ca. And if you're experiencing the symptoms that are new or significantly worse than you feel often, even now during this time, it's best to go and talk with your doctor. It's a physical condition that God can heal, yes, but He can also heal through doctors. So you don't have to suffer through it. You know, even when we're doing good, we can grow weary. Even when we're doing what the government tells us to do and our leaders tell us to do, we can get discouraged. Even when what we're doing is for the good of everyone, good of the realm, we can feel like we don't want to go on. We're done with this. There's a story in ancient Israel that happened after the time of Jeremiah. 70 years later, when they returned and Nehemiah came to rebuild the walls and he got permission from the king to come and do that, he went around and surveyed everything, and we get to our story in Nehemiah 4. In verse 6 of that chapter, Nehemiah 4, we read this. At last, the wall was completed to half the height around the entire city, for the people had worked with enthusiasm. You know, at the start of any challenge, at the start of anything new, even during this time, you know, we went into it whole hog. It was like, okay, what can we do and how are we going to do it? And let's try this and let's try that. And let's try this and let's try that. And let's do that. And we try our best to stay connected during this time of disconnect. We've done our best to keep encouraging people, whether it's on social media, whether it's through email, whether it's through phone calls, whether however we can. We want to keep on being the church and being the church together. And we got to live life and do life however we can. And whenever we do anything, it was tough. Well, it was tough at this time because we didn't know where the end was. We didn't know how long it was going to be. We didn't know what it was going to take. But anytime you do anything, there comes a point where you can still see the beginning, but you can't see the end. And when you can't see the end, that's the moment you're going to feel discouraged. when you feel like you've been doing this for some time, and when is it's never going to change? Oh, what's going on? And when you can't see the end, that's the moment. That's the time when you're going to be discouraged. How many of you feel like that could be any time now? Or maybe it already happened. Oh, man. I needed this sermon this week. I needed to prepare it. I know I needed it. And I thank God that he gave it to me, okay? Proverbs 13 tells us this. It says that hope deferred makes the heart sick, but a dream fulfilled is the tree of life. Our society is opening up now, and what we're being told is that the second wave of this COVID-19 could come in the fall. What that means, I mean, we don't know what it means, but what it means for us, there's a good potential that we aren't going to be able to meet together until sometime next year. Right now, we're allowed to meet in smaller groups together, and we're not supposed to do things like sing. We're trying to figure out how we can meet together and do all those things. How can we connect with each other and connect with God, given our current circumstance? We're trying to work all of those out and let you know in the future, but honestly, that might be the new normal for some time. In Nehemiah's time, when he came and surveyed the town, and they got to 50%, half the wall was done. It says the people of Judah began to complain. The workers are getting tired, and there's so much rubble to be moved. We will never be able to build the walls ourselves. Meanwhile, our enemies are saying, before they know what's happening, we're going to swoop down and kill them and end their work. The Jews who live near the camp told us again, they will come from all directions and attack us. We see four reasons we may want to give up. Fatigue, frustration, failure, and fear. Let me unpack those for you right now. The first one is fatigue. What does it say right there in verse 10? People of Judah began to complain, the workers are getting tired. Okay, fatigue is one of the reasons why you may want to give up. We're all going to grow weary. Like we will be physically tired, emotionally exhausted, and spiritually drained. We can grow weary in doing good. Psalm 127, it says, it's useless for you to go to work so hard from morning to until late night, anxiously working for food to eat, for God gives rest to those he loves. Are you getting enough rest? You know, fatigue is one of the reasons why you can grow weary. The second reason we may want to give up is frustration. Look what else it says in this verse 10, is that the workers are getting tired. There's so much rubble left to be moved. What is rubble? Rubble is the stuff that's left over at any construction site. Rubble is, you want to know what rubble is in your life? You want to clean a closet and you get half of it unpacked and you just get discouraged and push it all back. You want to clean out your garage and you get it all, half of it out, and you get discouraged and you just put it back in. You want to clean out the crawl space in your basement and you get going and it's just whatever. That's rubble. Rubble is the stuff that frustrates you. Rubble is those people that should know better when they call and ask for advice. Rubble is those frustrations, those lineups that just really shouldn't be lineups. The frustration of those people that whatever. Fill in the blank. Fill in the blank for whatever frustrates you. That is rubble. Let me give you three rules for rubble. And three rules for rubble is a part of life. Number two, you have to clean it out periodically. And number three, if you don't clean it out, it will eventually take over. You don't know what rubble is in your life? Ask the person you're living with or someone who's close to you. What are your frustrations? They're going to know. They can let you know. They can tell you what your rubble is that you want to clean out and you want to get rid of. What does it say? It says that we're to cast, give your burdens to the Lord, for he'll take care of you. He will not permit the godly to slip and fall. Fatigue is a reason you may want to give up. Frustration is a reason you may want to give up. The next one in that we find in our portion is failure. Failure can be a reason that you want to give up. What does it say in that verse? It says there's so much rubble, we can never be able to build a wall by ourselves. The one key for God to bless your life and your anointing is your answer to the question, how do you handle failure? We're all going to have failure. It's all going to not work out. You know, whether you hit a wall with your life, with your marriage, with your business, when your plans collapse, when COVID-19 comes in and destroys the economy, and you don't get to accomplish the things you want to accomplish in the time you want to accomplish them, what do you do? Some people hold a pity party. Some people start complaining. Some people lay the blame on others. Guess what? If first you don't succeed, congratulations, you're normal. All of us are going to have failure in our life. When you're a writer, rejection is your bedfellow. And how you learn to handle rejection is how much tenacity you're going to have in what you write and how you write. Fatigue might be a reason that you want to give up. Frustration might be a reason you want to give up. Failure might be a reason you want to give up. And let's look at this last one. Fear. Fear might be a reason that you want to give up. Look what it says in Nehemiah 4. In 11 and 12, verse 11 and 12, it says, meanwhile, our enemies were saying, before they know what's happening, we'll swoop down on them and kill them and end their work. And the Jews who lived near the enemy came and told us again and again, they will come from all directions and attack us. It's interesting that those who are closest were the ones who saw the most fear. When you are surrounded by people who speak negatively and discouragingly, you're going to be pre-programmed for fear. When you spend too much time listening to the 24-hour news cycle, you're going to give way to fear. The only solution is for us to take every thought captive and make it obedient to Christ. It's to think about the things that are good and right and holy, and whatever is good, whatever is true, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is holy, whatever no righteous, anything excellent or praiseworthy, think about these things. How do you know if you're motivated by fear? Fear triggers our fight or flight response. So if you feel like you want to run away, or you feel like you're ready to fight, you may be responding in fear. Bible tells us anything not done in faith is sin. So responding in fear is sin. Listen, you need to make sure you keep in step with the Spirit to know when you need to stand and use your authority and when you're simply fighting because you're responding out of fear. How do you know? Yeah, ask Holy Spirit. He will show you what you're responding to. You could be responding to fear of criticism or fear of embarrassment or fear of not being capable or fear of that you're insignificant or fear that you have to be perfect. What does God say about fear? He says, don't fear. He says, I'm with you always. He says, you got a good daddy who's going to take care of you so you don't have to worry about tomorrow. Paul says to worry about nothing, to pray about everything and give thanks. He says to think about the right things and do the right things, and the peace of God that transcends all understanding is yours. We need to trust God. So what do you do when it could be fatigue? It could be frustration, it could be failure, it could be fear that makes us feel discouraged. Let's look at what Nehemiah did. He said, so I placed armed guards behind the lowest part of the walls in the exposed area. I stationed people to stand guard by families armed with swords and spears and bows. Then as I looked over the situation, I called together the nobles and the rest of the people and said to them, don't be afraid of the enemy. Remember the Lord who is great and glorious, and fight for your brothers and your sons and your daughters and your wives and your home. Four things we can do when we want to give up. We can rest your body. You can restructure your life. You can refocus on God. And you can resist the discouragement. Let's look at those one at a time. Rest your body. You know, sometimes, it's always true. Many hands make light works, make light work. And we need to rest. I know some of you are saying, you know, I'm isolated. I'm getting more sleep than I ever got before. I'm asking you about rest. I'm asking you, have you decided to take a Sabbath? The Sabbath is the only commandment that we excuse in the New Testament. And yet Jesus said it's the only commandment that's for our benefit. We're not to be mastered by it, but it's for our benefit. So, do you take one day in seven and rest in his presence? Enjoy God in that day. A Sabbath rhythm could be not just 7 days a week, but whenever throughout the day. Do you take those pauses and those breaks just to enjoy God's blessing, just to enjoy him in his goodness? Sometimes the most spiritual thing you can do is to take a nap. You know, be like Jesus. Jesus took naps. Naps are a great way to spend a Sabbath. But it's not the only way, okay? When you want to give up, you need to rest your body. The next thing we need to do is restructure your life. What Nehemiah did was he stationed some people behind the lowest points of the wall and exposed places, posting them by family with their swords and spears and bow. Nehemiah restructured to face a possible threat. Same thing we're doing with the church. We are working as much as we can so that when we gather together, it's going to be as safe as possible for as many people as possible. We really need your prayer to have the wisdom on how to do that. But what about your life? If you're ready to give up in your life, maybe it's debt and you need to get that debt under control. You need to reorganize your budget so you can do that. And maybe you're out of shape. How do you reorganize your life so that you can get into shape? Maybe you're overcommitted. How do you reorganize your time so that you have enough, more than enough? You know, I believe in the verse that says God is ready to overwhelm you with more blessing than you could ever imagine, so that you'd always be taken care of in every way and have more than enough to share. In 2 Corinthians, he's talking about giving and money. But I believe that that applies to our time as well. I believe that it applies to our gifts and our abilities, that he multiplies. We got to stop thinking we have to do this, and instead think about it in terms of, how do I please God? How do I please God in my relationships? How do I please God in my health? How do I please God in my time? How do I please God in what I'm doing? You need to set up boundaries for sacred things like marriage and family and rest. You can't add hours in the day, so budget your time accordingly. When you want to give up, you got to restructure your life. The next thing you can do is to refocus on God. Nehemiah did this when he said to the people, "Don't be afraid of them. Remember the Lord who is great and awesome." You know, Jonah in the belly of the whale said this. He said, "As my life was slipping away, I remembered the Lord and my earnest prayer and your holy temple." David, when he was having the worst day of his life, look at what he says. He says, David was in great danger because all his men were very bitter about losing their sons and daughters and began to talk about stoning him. But David found strength in the Lord his God. How do we strengthen ourselves in the Lord? Can do it by choosing praise and joy, by meditating on the word, by waiting expectantly on the Lord, and by praying in the Spirit. We also can be strengthened by God through life-giving relationships because of grace, because of speaking, teaching, music, revelation, and supernatural gifts, prophecy, and by individuals. And through love, we can be strengthened in the Lord. When you want to give up, you need to refocus on God. So when you want to give up, rest your body, restructure your life, refocus on God, and resist the discouragement. Nehemiah said to fight for your families, your sons, your daughters, your wives, and your home. How do you resist the discouragement? Well, you and I need to make three choices. We need to choose to be grateful. We need to choose to praise him in the storm. And we need to choose to trust God with all of our heart. Choose to be grateful. Grateful, grateful, grateful. With thanksgiving, with thanksgiving, with thanksgiving. Philippians 4. Praise him in the storm. Psalm 13. How long, O Lord, have you will you forget me forever? How long must I wrestle with my thoughts? Look on me and answer. Yet will I praise you, my Savior and my God. Choose to trust God with all of our hearts. Lean on your own understanding, in all your ways acknowledge him, and he will direct your paths. Listen, your attitude determines your altitude. Discouragement is a choice. You can choose not to be discouraged by resting, restructuring, refocusing, and resisting. You resist by being grateful, by choosing to praise, and by trusting God with your whole heart. You can choose to be discouraged, or you can choose to shake off that discouragement. You can choose to strengthen yourself in the Lord. You can choose gratitude. You can choose to be trustworthy. You can choose all of these things. I want to leave you with a poem I wrote. I dated this. It was like 8 years ago already. And I'm not saying this is the poem I wrote. I'm saying this is a poem that helps me when I get discouraged. Because we all get discouraged. This is something that I go to and I repeat to myself because it helps put this entire message back into context, or it's easy enough for me to remember. Let's put one foot in front of the other. What do you do when life doesn't make sense? You put one foot in front of the other. What do you do when your plans are a mess? You put one foot in front of the other. What do you do when hope just seems lost? What do you do when you find out the cost? What do you do when your dreams are a loss? You put one foot in front of the other. Whatever happens, remember to praise. Whatever happens, choose gratitude, please. Whatever happens, always still trust. Whatever happens, your peace is a must. God's word that's a lamp to your feet will again be a light to your path. Until then, know his hidden rhythms still flow, and put one foot in front of the other. Can we pray? Heavenly Father, I do want to thank you. You are the God of all comfort who comforts us in our troubles. And I pray for anyone who needs your comfort today, that, Lord, it would overflow and that we'd be able to comfort others in their trouble. I pray, Lord God, that we would not give up in doing good, because we know that we'll see the results in the proper time if we don't give up. I pray, Lord God, that we would strengthen ourselves in you. I pray, Lord God, we would spend time in your word, spend time in your presence, spend time singing your praises. I pray, Lord God, that we would let you make us more like you in this journey and at this time. I thank you, Lord God, that we can praise you in the storm and praise you regardless of our situation. And Lord, I thank you that your truth is true whether COVID-19 is around or not. So Lord, I speak peace upon everyone who hears this today. And peace on their homes, and peace on their life, and peace to their storms. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.